27, and we need roll call.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Here.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
And Mr. Better?
Yes.
Okay, and welcome to any visitors here today, and please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Eric, you're up.
Usually I'm short and sweet, but today's going to be a little different. First thing is the building's custodial crew's going around, keeping the building really thorough, moving some teachers around different classrooms. And so they're staying really busy. The building's also very active this time of year, even though school's not in session. Kids in for conditioning, little camps, cheerleading practice, basketball, volleyball camps and stuff. Also, groundskeepers are out busy maintaining the mulch areas and mowing. Just a heads up, the main gym floor is being refinished the week of July 11th. So the main gym will be off limits that week. Also that week, it'll be the slowest time in the building with practices and everything. So that's also the week we're scheduled to have our parking lot resealed and restriped. So there'll be some days that they'll have to pylon off some areas so they can have full access. They don't have cars driving in and out. But they're both scheduled for the week of July 11th. We've had very good luck with our playground surface, that poured in place rubber. But we're to the point now, after 7 years, there's some wear spots in a few areas. So it's about close to $4,000 in repairs. Some hairline cracks, a few patches. And that company, they're finished up a job in Findlay right now, and they're hoping to be here this week or the beginning of next week. So working on getting those all repaired too. And then I got some handouts I handed out. One, I don't know if you remember or not, back in November last year, or actually not, probably October, I went to Columbus for a two-day maintenance seminar. And at that I found out that AEP would pay an outside company to come in and do an energy audit of our building called retro commissioning. And doing that retro commissioning, they would pay for the whole energy audit. All we had to do, since we're under 150,000 square feet by 3 feet, since we're just under that, we had to agree to $5,000 above grades. Anything that they could find that had a less than a 1.5 year payback. It's kind of a no-brainer. And so we set aside the $5,000 to do that. The company came in, and if you go through the report, kind of highlighted a few areas, they were shocked, I guess, a little bit. And one of the first ones they've ever turned down that they weren't able to find anything. So if you go through the report, the first page just kind of goes, I guess, page three, kind of the executive summary, just kind of about how efficient the building is, just kind of keeping costs down, staggered heat pumps, and when things start to stop. They also kind of go into the 2.0, the site energy consumption. This is a very good, for a fully cooled building, the 42.7 kilobtu per square foot is really an efficient building. All the equipment's operating efficiently, they can tell by that. And also, go to page 4.0. There's a few measures that they had. 4.1 was they found a few gaps at the main entrance doors, maybe like an inch and a half of the weather seal that was gone in the middle. And they recommended having those replaced and said that could maybe save up to $100 per year. And also around some of the heat pumps where the filters go in, there's some gaps, half inch up to about an inch gap here or there. They said that could maybe save $250 to $500 per year. But all the other stuff for the economizing control, the geothermal pump staging, and the generator block heater were some areas they thought they could maybe save us money, and at the end they found out there's nothing they could do to make it more efficient. So it's kind of a good report from them. We don't have to spend the $5,000. I'll look and get prices, get the gaps fixed around the doors, around the heat pumps. But other than that, it came back really good for being in the building for 7 years. So
it's great. That's
absolutely fabulous.
Yes, you would have thought they would come in and come up with something so they could make their $5,000, so they did. So
yeah, they did the full energy audit. They had two guys come in here and they want to know what time all the equipment got shut off in the building, what time they started on weekends, setback points, you know, for summertime, Christmas break, lock heaters, printers, copier, scanners throughout the building. They want to know everything. And they were in here for, I don't know, probably a day and a half, 2 days, two guys documenting everything. And I never heard anything. They said, well, we'll be back in touch in 3 weeks, and a month and a half went by, and it was over the winter time, so I didn't really think much about it. And I called them, and they said, we're still looking for areas we can try to save you money, so we haven't been in contact. They said, we're doing some more calling, we'll be back in contact with you. And then I went to an AEP seminar in Columbus this spring, and I asked them, because they're the ones that hired them to do the subcontractor. They said, we'll find out where they're at. We know they're having issues trying to find savings. And so then they got back in contact, and I just got this report on the 23rd. So last week I got it. So it was good to get the report. But it's also nice that we had to save the money and that we are being an efficient building. So that kind of leads me to my next part. For about a year and a half, I've been getting prices for interior lighting. Actually, about 6 years ago, I think we're in the building for about a year, and I started asking to take out all the new light fixtures in a brand new building and both gyms and change all those out. And because to be more efficient, we had a real quick payback period. So 2012, we changed all the lighting in both gyms, and that had 1.87 to 2.1 year payback. So we've already got the money back out of that. And then in 2013, we did the exterior lighting, all 84 light fixtures outside. And that there has about an 8 year payback. And that project's already been paid off, but we're reaping the benefits, I guess, from saving money every year on it. And I've been looking into interior lighting for quite some time, but the prices haven't been there. They've always been too high. And they finally actually got to a point now that they've leveled off where it's actually affordable for schools to do inside interior lighting. So the proposal I have, it's a 10-page agreement. This also includes, when I was at that spring meeting there, it was an AEP seminar. They don't sell lighting fixtures, they sell electricity. So the more you consume, the more they make. And when they're saying, if you guys haven't looked at changing your T12 bulbs to T8 or T5, you guys are way behind the times. If you haven't looked at getting proposals for outside lights, you're behind the times. And then they said, who's changed your outside lights? And about maybe a third of us have. Who's gotten prices for inside lights? And I had, but they weren't cost effective. And he says, now's the time to do it. We're telling you that now's the time. It's about the lowest you're gonna get for pricing, and it's gonna be the most rebate money we're gonna give. In the future, we're going to lessen the rebate money, the incentive to reducing the wattage. So kind of touch back with the company again. They proposed this back in 2015, again in 2015, early 2016, and I just got the most updated one from them. And prices have come down. Actually, in 2015, the same project was about $60,000 more overall for a cash payment. So just kind of going through, this would be every interior light. That's a trophy case light, all the light bulbs in here. They'd eliminate the ballast. They would eliminate all the bulbs. It'd all be LED bulbs. It also would eliminate all the transformers for all the trophy cases. And it would change the gym lighting a little bit. The main gym, they'd put what they call N lighting in. It's the newest technology. It gives you the capability of dimming certain areas, also focusing all the light on the main court and darker above the bleachers. If you want to push a button and have center court spotlight for introductions or anything else, it allows you all that capability for the main gym. And that's all included in this. And that's all the labor that they would actually fund the whole project. And then they also have it set up where, like the exterior lighting, you could either do a payment plan or do the cash option. I kind of, on the two pages, the last one, the LED upgrade, it kind of summarizes it the most, the way I would recommend it. Current wattage we have, if you take all of our light fixtures, it's 139,555 watts. They would be proposing that to all the light fixtures would be 55,404. So we'd be saving 84,151. The estimated AEP rebate that they've gotten from AEP, what they've been told would be $17,219. And they would recommend to have that taken directly towards the overall cost of the project and save us. And then savings would be $17,532 a year. And that's kind of guaranteed through what we, the electricity that we use compared to what we will be using, that's just numbers. They know how much it is per kilowatt, so that's the easy part to do. This next part's a little harder. The companies kind of, because I had multiple companies bid on this, and both of them had, one of them said the operating for bulbs and ballast and operating maintenance, what they called it, like my salary or something, but they had it figured up like $6,200 or $9,300. And found out over the last 4 years, I buy all my bulbs and ballasts from the same company, and this is what we paid over the last 4 years. So that's more practical on how much money you would save, the $4,423 just in bulbs and ballast in a year's time. So if you include all the savings from the electrical savings and the bulbs and ballasts, you're looking at $21,955 in savings a year. The life expectancy of an LED bulb is 50,000 hours. If you contact AEP or anyone else, they have a general number. Schools on average use their bulbs 2,271 hours less if you're using occupancy sensors like we are. But if somebody's just going in, flipping the light switch on and shutting off at the end of the day. So our bulbs to the lease should last 22.016 years. And so the Energy Optimizer USA, they would do all the installation, they would fund the whole project. And then at the end of the project, if we wanted to pay them a cash option or make payments, that would be entirely up to what you guys do. The next two parts kind of summarize the four instance part. If you did the three-year warranty, the cash option, it's $184,471. If you did the three-year warranty, the payment plan with your interest, that they're going to get 6% interest, you're at $199,000. If you do the 10-year, all the way down the bottom of the page in red, the 10-year warranty with paying cash, you would get 7 more years of warranty for $4,918.44 less over a 10-year compared to the 3-year making payments. So to me, the best case scenario would be get the 10-year warranty, pay the $194,397, and pay the cash option. You give you 7 more years of warranty on all the fixtures compared to the 3-year payment plan, and it'd save you money. And then also on that second page, it also shows you what the payback period would be for if you did the 10-year warranty, cash option, it's 8.85 years, similar to what the exterior lighting was. You figure the bulbs last you 20 years on average. So out of 8.4 years, that gives you 11.6 years left the bulb should last. So over the course of the next 11.6 years, you could be saving $254,000 plus. That is if electrical rates stay the same and they don't increase over the next 20 years. So I know it's a lot of numbers. I'm a math person, so I love numbers. But over the course of 20 years, you figure 20 years at $21,255 a year, you're saving over $425,000.
I know I'm a long-term person, and I like the way that sounds, but what do you guys think as far as short-term versus long-term? I know that's a huge chunk of change. I knew you were going to say that, Craig. I knew that was going to come out of your mouth.
I mean, so I understand.
We had the same discussion back in 2013 when we did all the exterior lighting, and we made one quarterly payment, and then we paid the whole balance off after one payment. So I just...
Before we start thinking too much about that money, I'm looking at your next steps here,
yes.
Eric, and it says installation completed September 2016. The kids will be in session at the end of August, so is there going to be some...
The first page, middle of the thing, they work at our convenience, that they'll come in the summertime if they can get all the material here on time. Otherwise, they'll come in on second and third shift hours, not to interact or be in any disturbance at all to us. It'd be at our convenience. We tell them what areas of the building they can be in. I give them a key and a fob so they can get in and out to get their equipment. I have custodial staff in the building to kind of make sure if they need anything, they're around.
Okay, so if they don't get it done before the kids come in, they're working around.
Excellent. Yeah. Okay. I asked them, they said if we signed the contract next week or this week, they would start ordering all the bulbs and everything, get stuff in, get stuff, start staging. Then they'd have a meeting with the district, find out exactly where they can stage stuff, start getting time frames. They said that there's about a 4-week window to get all the parts in, to get all the stuff that they need to order, and then about a 5-week period to actually install all the stuff. Any of the lighting we want to keep, any of the light fixtures, like these, they'll keep all the light fixtures. They'll remove the ballast and the bulbs and put LED in, direct wire, eliminate a lot of future headaches. But like our gym lighting that we had replaced in 2012, if we want to keep that lighting, they're going to put new state-of-the-art LED lighting in with motion sensors and dimming capability. We can keep all that lighting fixtures. So they'll take them all down, put them on a skid for us, and we can either take them down to the football field athletic building or bus barn or somewhere and be able to reuse those.
That's good.
And I know it is a chunk of change, and we talked, what was our last week, when we were talking about the expansion, and if it was my money, what would I do? And we said that didn't make a lot of sense, and, if this was my money, which, I mean, it's community's money, I mean, it makes sense to at least consider it, I mean, that's a big chunk of change over, the next 10.
Nick, I put in there on the bottom line on each one, the cost to the district, if you did the payment plan for like a 10-year warranty, you're looking at cost the district an extra $71,785. It also changes the payback period from an 8.85 year to a 12.12, so it's going to take you 4 more years to pay off the project that way.
If you do the payment plan.
Yeah.
Yeah, which, I think as much as it would cost in interest, we'd be better off paying it.
So the company is like the number one company AEP recommends. They do the most projects of this type of anyone. All they do is do schools. They don't do factories or any other shops or malls or anything. They're focused on schools and municipality type of stuff.
And when do they need to know this, Eric? I'm sorry.
They give us a contract. It's the last page of, they kind of have references on how much money on page 8.
Good.
Other schools that they've done, how much the project costs, how much you're saving them a year. They have a whole long list of references if you like more of them. And pretty much, you know, the last page, page 9, would be option A or B. Option B, I did not think was cost effective. Their other choice was actually to go through and replace all the fixtures with new LED fixtures. Cost quite a bit more. And actually, it was going to use more wattage than just changing all the bulbs over. So if you look at page 2, cash payment options, option B, 3 years at $331,000 compared to $184,000. And the bad thing is the payback's worse, because if you go to page 3 and look at option A, the third column over, pull proposed wattage with the new lights, they're going to get us down to 55,000 watts by just changing the bulbs. If they change all the fixtures, they can only get it down to 78,430. So you're not going to be saving as much money per year for electrical consumption.
You said you recommend the 10-year warranty.
I would prefer to add seven extra years for your warranty at a little under $10,000. That averages out about $125 a month for a warranty, and that's all materials.
What's a fixture cost if one goes bad?
The bulb, right now, the current bulb prices are about 12 or 14 bucks a bulb. They used to be, a year and a half ago, they were about $50 a bulb.
So they'd replace the bulb. Is there any just regular manufacturer warranty on the bulb itself?
No, they come with a one-year warranty.
Oh, okay.
And the good thing about this company is, the other companies that quoted, they had their own electrical companies making their own fixtures and they're stamping their name to them, and mom and pop shop type of things. And this company, they only use the top four, you know, Lithonia, Cree, they use it the top, and this way they have good warranty issues with all of them. Companies that have been in business forever.
Just out of curiosity, is there an option for no warranty at all or not?
I didn't know
what it would do the price, not saying I'd be, you know, for that or not. I'm just curious.
I mean, it's hard to argue that for 10 grand to get the extra 7 years is pretty
good. I agree.
And by doing the 10-year cash, it's actually cheaper than the 3-year payment plan. That's the, get 7 extra years and save an extra $4,800. That's the thing I was surprised on, but they're 6% interest. And actually, their savings could be more than that. I was on the low end. They were actually at $6,300 for a bulb and ballast savings, and they figure in a little bit of maintenance time, you know, my time going in to change them out, rewiring fixtures, wire nuts, electric, you know, connections and stuff like that.
And you're running part of the building's new.
I know.
Changed lights once and some of it.
Yeah. Well, actually, when we started off, I changed every light bulb in the building from a 32-watt bulb to a 28-watt bulb. And AEP gives us a dollar for every bulb that we change. Well, we're also saving, and the bulbs I got for a little bit over a dollar, so we pretty much got it all done for free. And we had somebody from Job Works, a gentleman that graduated from Ford County, actually went through and changed almost all of them, and Job Works paid for all of his salary for that summer. So this is about the fifth. We added vending misers on all the vending machines, so they automatically shut off and come on as people need them, not running all day long.
How do you feel about the 10-year
cash
as far as financially?
I think we have to take it probably PI money potentially. I'm not sure where the fund is, but I think it's fairly healthy.
For the payback that you get out of it, I mean, this is, to me, it's pretty straightforward.
If you go uptown, you see the village, they're starting to change some of their exterior lighting on their parking lot poles or the street lights downtown. If you've been in the Shell station recently, I don't know if you noticed theirs at all, but they changed all theirs all over to LED. Of course, it's a lot smaller project too, but they've changed theirs over their interior lighting. First project I've seen in Hicksville had inside lighting LED. They kind of went to a lot brighter blue, like a 6,000 Kelvin. It's not a good look to me. This would be like a 4,100 Kelvin. It'll be a little bit brighter than this. It's 3,500. The gym's 5,000. It's more of a white. This will be in between that.
read some stuff today that the six and 6,500 Kelvin is, they're seeing that there's some, actually some medical issues that can occur.
Some cities, just seen an article a couple days ago, they had posted the city, did down all their main, they had pictures before and after, and that's given all sorts of different, like heart conditions and stuff like that, rhythm. And they showed a picture before and after, it was a drastic difference. But yeah, we have 6,500 in our food prep areas and in our aquarium, and that's all we have.
Do you need something on us tonight, right, Madam President?
I think that since we aren't going to have our next meeting until August, we should probably, yes.
The longer wait, it costs about $2,000 a month to wait.
And there you
no
go.
No pressure.
Eric has always been, you know, on top of that kind of stuff, so he has definitely saved the district lots of money for the time.
There's no question. That's true.
I mean, I'm sure he's done his homework on this. And
is this something we have to vote on, or just give a nod?
We have a vote on it.
That would be a motion.
Yeah.
I can give you a copy of
it. All right.
That would be added.
So what we should probably do, I think, is just on make an addendum to our addendums that we do that, and when we get to the addendums, address the situation.
Okay.
Is that copacetic?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eric. Good job. Okay. Well, elementary first this time.
Hello. I apologize for my lateness. I got caught in downtown Fort Wayne traffic in every red light possible. Third grade ELA results are in. 61 out of 81 students earned a passing score of at least 700 for a passage rate of 75.3%. The state requirement to meet the performance indicator for this year's report card is 68%. So after the fall administration of this assessment, we were at 52% passage rate. However, all third grade students did meet the requirements of the third grade guarantee and were all promoted to the fourth grade. The remainder of our scores are supposed to be in tomorrow. And the CCIP has been submitted for approval. This year's allocation was for $190,749.63. And we carried over roughly $30,000 from last year's allocation. That is all we have on our side.
All right, well, the month of May, of course, as we know, preparing for graduation. We had a lot of events going on. I know that we talked about the District Art Show, which was great. We also had our Senior Citizen Breakfast, which we spoke about already. All of our awards banquets went very well. They're underclassmen, middle school, and high school. We actually would like to thank Mr. Nathan Farrell and Mr. Lucas Smith for working with our seniors and Grace United Methodist Church for the baccalaureate service. One thing that I had noticed is my last 3 years here, I think the first year, my baccalaureate, there was only 7 kids. And then my second year, we had 11. This year, I think we had 16 kids. So, and I admit, you know, we are putting a little more emphasis on advertising that and educating the kids on what it is and what it's about. And I think it's an awesome opportunity. And the kids did a great job this year. So, glad to see that that's growing and becoming what it used to be.
And I think it should be noted that this is a small class, and that's actually a higher percentage
yes.
of kids attending.
That is correct.
It was correct.
We have our first session of summer school was just completed. It was from June 6th to June 16th. We had 6 kids in summer school taking advantage of the credit recovery program there. And of course, they all took advantage of it. They all passed those classes, so that's excellent. The second session is the 2 weeks following the July 4th weekend. Mr. Andrew Lawrence and Mr. Mike Blue are running that program. So again, I think there are 8 kids in the July session. Our middle school summer school program will be hosted by Mr. Brent Suffol and Mrs. Bosselman. That's the first 2 weeks of August. And again, that's not credit recovery. That's more revisiting the skills and the concepts that they should have learned in junior high and making sure that they understand that. I always want to thank our teaching staff, support staff, and office staff for working together to provide a great commencement. As always, we do a real nice job. You know, Eric's staff preparing the gymnasium and how nice it looks. And of course, Tara Welling and all the teachers that volunteer all their time and putting together a great commencement. I'd like to thank the graduated seniors of the class of 2016. I'll tell you what, it's amazing when you're a senior now, the things that you do those last couple of months. And I started joking around, you'll be a huge basketball fan. You know, we refer to March Madness as that great time during the NCAA tournament and conference tournaments. For seniors, it's March Madness for them too, because I just cannot believe everything that goes on starting in March and what they're expected to complete by the time graduation comes along. And of course, you know, that senior class, they were a great, great group of kids. And I look forward to working with all our students next year. But I really try to take the time to look at the seniors and talk to them about being leaders and talking to them about, you know, kind of all the kids that look up to them. So looking forward to working with the class of 2017. A few items here, future events. The Ohio State mandated end of course exams for our end of the building. Those results will be released tomorrow. So I'll be able to report that information to everyone at the August meeting. The athletic department, admin team, of course, working with the athletic boosters. We met today and we've been discussing it for a few months now. We're looking to develop a memorial at Aces Field to honor Noah Carrickson, and we're hoping to have that in place and ready to go by the football season. But I know that's going to take a lot of time and effort, and we're using all the input we can get from all the people that are necessary to make it a great opportunity for us to, again, make sure people understood the impact that Noah had, not just on our football team, but on our district and the communities around us. In August, there's going to be two items that are going to be added to the agenda that I kind of wanted to throw out there real quick. First thing, we're going to recommend a flat fee for school fees for grades 7 through 12 at $58. I was told that wasn't on the agenda. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we got it
here. I got a text message like at 5:45 and said it wasn't on the agenda, so I didn't check. Is it on there? Okay. That's on there, that's a bonus. If not, I apologize for
it
that.
It should be.
Because I thought it was supposed to be also.
I remember seeing it.
Yeah.
Is it on there?
Yeah.
So I
thought
it okay, good. Okay, thank you. I'll have to text that person back after the meeting. Also, we're looking to recommend a potential change to how we figure our class rankings. And I've spoken to Steph multiple times about this. Currently, after seven semesters, we establish our rankings of our students. So if you're a valedictorian, you know pretty much January 13th, roughly, that you're the valedictorian. And I hate to say it, but some of the kids really shut down after that. A lot of other districts, including Bryan, am I correct, Steph? They go up until the last day of school now.
For seniors, yes.
For seniors. Because it's different now. You don't have to worry about balancing out a grade book or figuring out averages for 120 kids anymore. It's as simple as with Power School, every time you enter a grade, it's figured for you. So the information is available instantly, which makes it easier. The only issue we really run into is newspapers and television stations that want to know who your valedictorian is so you put on a commercial. To be honest with you, if you're the valedictorian at that time and you're on a commercial or you're in the newspaper, great. But if you're not, when it's time to figure out where you belong, I hate to say it, but that's not really our issue. That's more the television's issue. So.
And actually, it's even easier because what happens in Bryan City Schools is they just send out the kids that are potential top 10%.
Okay.
And then we only have to make sure that their grades are in and ready to go on that day after the seniors are done. And then we can add to the grades of the other students as need be. But
yeah, but that's something I believe it's under the old policy that it's seven semesters. So that's something that we're all going to have to really consider and make sure we do our homework. But it's something I think we need to look into doing. Outside of that, I just want to introduce our two visitors here real quick. Of course, Amber Mack, which at our board meeting we had on the 17th of June, is that correct? 10th of June, that's a week off. She was voted in for our new 7 through 12 math position, so congratulations and of course welcome. And of course our other visitor is Mr. Andy Hunter. He is the proposed assistant principal for the middle school high school. Thank you.
And congratulations on getting hired in. It's really
school district. Anything else, Jeff, are you all set?
I'm done.
Okay. Denny, we'll go to Fort County Career.
We will have a levy, Fort County's going to have a levy on the ballot in November, $1 million for operating, and excuse me, is either since 1983 or 1987, the last time Fort County asked for an operating millage. This year, we are $500,000 short by the state. Career centers are not getting the money, local schools are getting the money. And so it's creating a cash shortfall for us in, we're okay this year and next, but after that, we start deficit spending. So we're looking at different cuts if that millage doesn't occur. We're hoping that maybe the state comes back with some money, but as of right now, we don't believe that's going to be, Mr. Meister doesn't believe that's going to be happening. So we've been talking about this for a while, and we made it public last month here in June. And so that will be on the November ballot coming up with the $1 million levy. And then otherwise, just the normal stuff of closing out the year end and the associated stuff with running the school district. The millage was the big thing. So we're in the middle of contract negotiations too. Nothing to report any further on that.
You think it'll go relatively smoothly?
No. Contract negotiations always go smoothly.
We're in the middle of contract negotiations.
Nothing else to report.
Anything else, Dan?
No, ma'am.
Thank you. Superintendent's report.
Thank you. We kind of mentioned before the meeting started that Melissa's still working between Patrick Henry and here, so it's been difficult for her and I to really get together, because when she is here, she's really focused and concentrating on what's going on in her office. But, you know, we hit each other from time to time as we pass by with different topics and stuff that we need to do, but I'm sure that as we progress, we get over here more permanently, that it'll work out better for us. The Relay for Life was here last Friday night. It was a big success for them, and I'm thankful that we were able to accommodate them. It worked out so well. I think it was a good decision for us. End of the year stuff, for me, pretty basic. I've kind of been working on beginning of the year stuff, actually, for quite some time. And Jeff has the money he had to get spent. And I said, I know what to do with it. I'm good with spending money, you know. So I'm putting together an administrative retreat for my administrators early on in August. Be a one-night thing, and during that time I'm working I've been meeting with Jen, and we're going to focus on some curriculum and special ed things for the day, and also establish different goals and areas that we want to use in particular for the year in the areas of curriculum and special education. Holly, as you know, was very good at special education, and I think that's void for us, and so I want that to be a focus for our administrative team. I want to also establish some expectations and things that I'd like, as we move forward, that I have for our team and my philosophy of what I want. And so I think it'll be a good time. Just as we do professional development with our teaching staff periodically, I think it's important to do that with our administrative team. I think that's a great way to start the year off with that. I also wanted to mention that our safety team, and when I say our safety team, I'm talking about the people that were authorized to carry by the board, recently attended the Buckeye Firearms Faster Training. And the training consisted obviously of gun handling, emergency response medical trauma training, which was a new piece that team has not had, and an on-site active school training at a high school that they participated in an actual school. It was pretty intense, they said. The team reported that all the members successfully passed the training, which means that they met the standard for the Ohio Peace Officer Training Academy semi-automatic qualification course that's recognized by the Attorney General, Mike Dwayne. I think it's definitely worth noting that the team values their responsibility as a high-level priority, and is constantly working to maintain effective skills. I think that's important for us to know. This team is properly trained to protect our students and staff and recognizes the need for ongoing training to remain effective in the event of an active shooter. I did thank the team on your behalf and shared your appreciation for them accepting this high level of security that puts them at a greater risk for injury. And, you know, with it just seems like there's constantly stuff happening in our society, so I applaud you for your decision that you made back in December. I think it was a good decision, and I can assure you that the team that you, that we have, that we don't share those names, obviously, but works very hard at making sure that they're maintaining effective skills. I wanted to share that with you. I think that's all I have on my list. Yeah, I passed this around earlier. It's a thank you note from Kate from on behalf of the academic team for their time in Chicago and the success that they had there. I think you all saw that already. So, okay. Anything else? Any questions for me?
All right, moving on to the consent agenda. We don't have any items to be removed as you guys have been through this. No. Do we have to say we're adding an item? I've never had to do that before.
No, I think when we get to the agenda,
we get to it.
Just when we get to the agenda, just add it. Okay. All right, so roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Missouri?
Yes.
And Mr. Vedder?
Yes.
Okay, passes 5-0. Okay, motion to go over minutes and financials.
So moved.
Thank you, Denny.
I'll second.
Okay, do you want to go ahead?
My report's going to be pretty brief. It's been kind of been a crazy period of time here, but just a few things. In your packet, you'll find there is, I'm establishing a fund for the class of 2020 so that that can get going. Also, establishing funds for high schools that work, Idea B, Title I, Title II, and ECSE. Those funds to be established there. Also, some petty cash funds. And we're also accepting the donation of $500 from Paul and Denise Obermeyer for scholarship in memory of Noah Erickson. Just a couple other items. I don't know if you want me to speak about it now or later, but in the addendum you'll find the letter or the amended certificate of estimated resources for this year. And you'll also find temporary appropriations for 2017, which I set those at like 80% of what was expended this year. So we'll tweak that come September. And then you'll also see the, I did give you a revised copy because I had a little mistake, but there's a revision there for the permanent appropriations for 2016. And then just a couple other things. In your packet, you'll also find some general things that need to be approved, but there's Ohio deferred compensation, an adoption of an agreement, and basically that information is just to establish a 457 fund. I've actually contributed to this since I worked at the Village of Paulding, so it's something that I would like to continue to participate in, and we just needed to accept an agreement on that so that Hicksville School Center is kind of a part of that. So any member of the district that would like to participate in that can also participate in that plan. Other than that, I really don't have anything.
I'm assuming there's no associated cost with
no,
that?
No, it's all from, it's just my contribution
okay.
amount.
Okay.
So, it'll just be withheld from my check and then sent.
We're in good shape here.
Yes.
But
the
that's stuff. Something that's going to be open to all staff then, is
yes.
it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good deal.
Yeah, it's yes. a good program. Like yeah. I really like it. So. So. I don't know if anybody has any questions or
any discussion over any of the financials or stuff.
I think as of right now, I'm hoping to, at Patrick Henry, kind of wrap up the end of their fiscal year and hopefully maybe get that done by next Tuesday, Wednesday to the latest, and then hopefully be here pretty much full time. So that'll be that'll be nice to be one place all the time, so I'm looking forward to that.
And I'll be gone for a while, so she can really get settled in.
Any other discussion or commentary?
Just again, another thank you to Paul and Denise. That's very nice of them to do that. Okay. employment. Oh, we need roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
And Mr. Vedder?
Yes.
All right, passes 5-0. Employment of certified staff. Motion, please. Thank you, John. Second?
I'll second.
Recommend issuing a 5-year contract to Keith Countryman as superintendent commencing August 1st, 2016 and ending July 31st, 2021. Any discussion?
Where do we start?
All right, so.
Hey, I can renew my birth certificate.
Go back
there's
and drive.
There's my friends uptown. I can buy it. I've done that before too, so. Just give it size sign. I don't know what to do.
No, Keith, I'm happy to have you 5 more years.
Thank you.
Seriously, do a great job.
We appreciate you, Keith.
We do.
Most of the time.
Well, I'll still be real.
We could do a whole roast if you want.
No.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
Mr. Vedder?
Maybe, but yes.
Passes 5-0. Okay. A motion. Move on to the next item, please.
I'll move.
Okay.
Second.
Thank you. Recommend issuing a 1-year contract to Andrew Hunter as assistant middle school high school principal commencing August 1st, 2016 and ending July 31st, 2017 pending certification. Thank you for coming, by the way, Mr. Hunter. So is it Andrew, Drew, Andy?
Andy. Where are you coming from?
Tenora.
Okay.
It's actually kind of funny. He comes from Tenora. I think she was a former student of his at Tenora.
Did you have Mr. Wonderly too?
Yeah. Small world.
What were you teaching?
High school social studies. And a little bit of 7th and 8th grade last year social studies as well.
How long have you been
there? 9 years. I've been the head basketball coach the last 4 years. Before that, I was JV coach and coach at Watson as well.
Welcome aboard.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All right. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
And Mr. Vedder?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Moving on. We have a motion, please.
Go ahead.
All right. Linda first and then second. Thank you. Recommend issuing a 3-year contract to Liz Perna as school psychologist commencing August 1st, 2016 and ending July 31st, 2019. Discussion.
Just that I will say that Liz was the first person I hired after being appointed superintendent. And one of the best hires we've made. She's been amazing for our district, and Minda can speak for sure that you know what we dealt with over the years with a different psychologist. I don't know how many times we've had a new one. It's been a blessing having her, and she does a perfect job. She's very, very good.
She comes into the classroom, observes the kids, knows them. Excellent.
Very good.
Roll call, please.
Ms. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
And Mr. Vedder?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Moving on to the next item.
I'll move.
Okay. Recommend to approve the following as instructors for ACT review sessions at Hicksville High School from June 6, 2016 through June 8, 2016 with no cost to the district. Student registration fees of $10 per class or $25 total will pay for the instructor's time. Apostrophe missing there. Arlena Fleming, English, Donna Lysett, Math, and Paul Payne for Science.
To recommend to approve Andrew Lawrence's summer credit recovery instructor to provide a maximum of 72 hours of credit recovery through the Digital Learning Center at current hourly rate. Sessions will be held on the following dates from 8 a.m. to noon. June 6th through June 10th, June 13th through June 16th, July 11th through 15th, and July 18th through 21st. To recommend issuing a one-year limited contract to Paul Obermeyer as classroom teacher with 6 years experience at a master's degree for the 2016-2017 school year. This will be for 30% of a workday and shall be for the position of co-athletic director. Recommend to amend Jessica Saunders' teaching contract to read 2 years teaching experience with a bachelor's degree for the 2016-2017 school year. And this is just a change because we had it a 1 year and it should have been 2 years. To recommend to approve the following supplemental contracts for extended days during the 2016-2017 school year to be served before and after the scheduled school year. Mr. Mike Blue, 25 days, Jeff Ott, 10, Matt Hoffman, 25, Zach Kohlmeyer, 10, Marilyn Leone, 10 days, Rachel Mann, 7, Paul Obermeyer, 10, and Jeff Schaefer, 35. To recommend to approve the resignation from Josh Fries as head junior high football coach, which was in all of those papers. Recommend to approve the following supplemental contracts for the 2016-2017 school year. Mike Blue, Josh Fries, Chris Gagan, Joy Geiger, Jeff Hott, Alicia Nye, Paul Obermeyer, Missy Ruoff, and Joey Stevenson. To recommend to approve the following as kindergarten jumpstart camp instructors from August 15th to August 19th, 2016. I keep thinking of it as kindergarten boot camp, but that's probably the wrong way to think about it. But that would be Missy Ruoff and Alicia Nye. And I'm sorry, is it Alicia or Alicia? I never remember.
Destiny.
Alicia.
Yeah. Okay. It's Destiny. Actually.
It is what
she goes by.
She is called Destiny. Okay. And to recommend to approve the following as 50-50 middle school summer school instructors from August 1st to August 12th, 2016, Brent Suffel and Nikki Bosselman. Any discussion?
I'd like to talk real quick about the ACT review session. And as important as that is, I mean, that's as important as GPA. I mean, do we get a lot of kids to go to this? Is this something we can offer, you know, more of and even not charge for it? I just know when you look back at the ACT scores based on schools, the last thing I looked at, Hicksville's wasn't as high as what a lot of their local schools were. And as important as that is for scholarships, what can we do to maybe, you know, enhance that? And I guess if we don't have kids going to it, maybe that's not important. Or what do we got to do to get them to go to it?
We only had about, I want to say, 7 kids attend that. I think that there's 2 things going on right there. And this is just opinion because other people have different opinions on it, so we're trying to figure out the best way to handle it. Some people feel that our students should not take the ACT until they're juniors. Others want our freshmen to start taking the PSAT into the ACT and work your way, because the more times you take it, the more comfortable you become, the more familiar you become with it, and scores can go up. I mean, I'll give you a perfect example, and without using a name, we had a student as a freshman take the PSAT, as a sophomore take the ACT, and by the time they took it this past spring, their scores went up 6 points. And that's something that, in my opinion, I'd like to see more of our students taking the time to take it 2 or 3 times if need be. A lot of our kids are only taking it once as a senior. They don't retake it. And I think that hurts them. When it comes to the review piece, I think it'd be nice to be able to do something during the school year, I agree, rather than waiting until summer, because when the kids hit summertime, a lot of your top kids are taking advantage of it. And yeah, their scores are increasing, but their scores are typically already up there already. The wrong clientele are attending that class. You're right. It's the kids that are scoring the, you know, I'd say the upper teens and the lower 20s that we're trying to get to the 24s and 25s rather than a 19 or a 20 or 21 that need to take advantage of it. So that's kind of in discussion right now. We're hoping to make that change.
I'd like to comment on that and wanting to talk to you after the meeting because my son took it this summer just in June and he was the only sophomore there. Brian, when he took it, there's numerous juniors in there. And had I known as a parent about this class, I would have encouraged him to take it because I don't think they realize the importance of it. From having a senior who, or one who just finished her freshman year of college, we did not realize as parents the importance of the ACT and what that meant for scholarships and getting into colleges. And now, you know, second time around, Andrew's a freshman, or sophomore now, was a sophomore, and trying to push him into it. And now what he wants to do, he has to have his the scores that he wants by the middle of his junior year. It's not his senior year for what he's going for. So that's why he started early. So I would like to see a little bit more information, especially to the parents, because the more
I think in the past, the reason you didn't have the information is because it's only been advertised that seniors, Grand County seniors, that's the problem.
Yeah, I would definitely. I mean, had we known about that as a sophomore, he would have been there.
And we're also trying to transition the whole PSAT issue, getting our freshmen and sophomores to do that, and not just wait until you're a junior or senior and say, oh, I'm going to take the ACT, because that's kind of what's happening.
I couldn't agree more with you. The more you can take that test, the better you're going to
do. Absolutely.
And I had several discussions about that last year, so we're sure that that's going to be happening at an earlier time. Yeah.
And I guess for
schools
for Mike,
do offer that during the school year. That's my great.
I should say, from my standpoint, even if it costs the district some money, I think in the long run, I think it's going to be a good thing for the kids. So, and if there could be something during the school year, like you said, during the summer, I mean, they're zoning out, they got jobs or whatever.
We have kids here at 6 a.m. until 7 at night now with athletics, too. I mean, I see you every day with cross country football, basketball, baseball. I mean, it's just amazing. And they look at that as not an opportunity, but another reason to miss practice or not to do this or not to do that. So it's unfortunate when we offer it. Minda, I want to go back to her real quick.
Sure.
And I want to answer what you were bringing up. You mentioned that your grandchildren have taken advantage of that program. Is that an actual class or is that an online? Because I had heard it's not Grad Point, but there's another program where people can take, or students can take an online ACT prep course, which that's great if it works. I don't know if it does or not. But I would rather have an elective or something available for kids to have have a teacher in front of the room working through the questions.
School.
Yeah. Because I know there are some schools using GradPoint, which is what we use for our credit recovery, because it's all online. Yes. I don't know if that works. I prefer to avoid that, in my opinion.
I'm going to think out loud. This might be something that you could address in home base. If there are a couple teachers who have home base open, relatively open. I don't know if you do have free home-based teachers that would be willing to do ACT prep for kids who want to come in, because it's every other month that ACT is offered. And so maybe, I don't know.
Honestly, I'm looking, I think one problem that we've seen in scheduling is with our electives, it's a small school problem. You know, small schools, we don't have as many teachers, not as many opportunities, not as many classes available to fit everyone's schedule. We need more junior, senior electives, and I think if we could get an ACT prep course in there available to our juniors and seniors, I think that they could take advantage of that.
You guys don't have a study skills class here, that's right?
Yeah,
because I teach that, and so for me, that's part of the.
We're also looking to implement required electives for our freshmen, because we're having freshmen and sophomores take electives, and they could be juniors and seniors, they don't know what to take anymore because they've taken everything. So we're working on that piece. That just takes time to see, pretty much through 3 years of scheduling, I'm starting to recognize patterns and seeing the same problems, and now we're trying to solve those problems. So
I'll check the
board. Thank you.
Any other discussion on any of these ideas, issues? Okay. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carey?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
And Mr. Vedder?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Moving on to the employment of classified staff.
Second.
Thank you, Debbie. To recommend issuing a 3-year contract to Ruthann Pierman as food service director commencing August 1st, 2016 and ending July 31st, 2019. Any discussion? I think Ruthann does a great job.
I don't hear anything but positive.
Well, except for those phone calls when your children decide to leave the check in their bags for a week instead of handing it in that little square.
Do it online.
Any other discussion? Okay. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Kunzler?
Yes.
And Mr. Cook?
Yes.
All right. Motion passes 5-0. Next item of business. Motion, please.
Thank
you, Fred.
Second.
Thank you, Jen.
Recommend to approve the following supplemental contract change for the 2016-2017 school year. Brent Brickle from the junior high assistant football coach to junior high head football coach. To recommend to approve the following supplemental contracts for the 2016-2017 school year pending certification: Robin Bauer, Nikki Miller, Amy Stabler, Eddie Tunis, and Missy Yoder. To recommend to approve the following as a fall sport volunteer for the 2016-2017 school year: Kenny Baird for football. Discussion. All right.
Cool.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Musser?
Yes.
And Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Services and agreements. So, to recommend to approve the following resolution is stated: whereas the district is a participating member of the Ohio High School Athletic Association, and whereas the district therefore has agreed to the rules and regulations promulgated by the OHSAA, is therefore resolved as follows. The operation of unmanned aerial vehicles, UAVs, commonly known as drones, is prohibited on Hicksville Exempted Village School District premises during district-sponsored contests, including scrimmages and previews, practices, and activities under the auspices of the Ohio High School Athletic Association. District officials may deny admission or entry to anyone attempting to use a UAV until the event has been completed, and any exceptions to this regulation must be approved in advance by the superintendent.
That was recommended in the past. It has been to I've had some talks with John Kaler about that, and as you know, we have a drone of our own that we want to use for to get some footage of those kind of things, and so we felt it was appropriate to do this to prevent, you know, an invasion.
Yeah, heat.
Okay, any other discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Missouri?
Yes.
And Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Thank you. Next order of business motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Denny.
I'll second.
Thank you, Brad. Recommend to approve the following rate for high school summer 2016 classes: $60 per credit for summer credit recovery through the Hicksville Digital Learning Center per course. Recommend to approve a service agreement with Northwest Ohio Juvenile Detention Training and Rehabilitation Center from July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2017. Amount of service is $38 per student per weekday for students assigned to the Juvenile Detention Center. Recommend to approve a service agreement with Central Ohio Medical Review, COMR, for the purpose of the district preparing the medical review services and related therapy referrals for students who are undergoing evaluation for or receiving any of the related services of occupational, physical, or speech language therapies or audiology services as a component of their IEP service plan. The term of the agreement shall be for 1 year, commencing May 1st, 2016 and ending April 30th, 2017. The cost of said services, excluding nursing services, will be $40 per medical review, $60 for students with two therapies, and $75 for students with three therapies. Recommend to approve a service agreement with Northwest Ohio Educational Service Center for technical services for the 2016-2017 school year. Recommend to approve membership fees with the Northwest Ohio Computer Association for fiscal year 2017. Recommend to approve a memorandum of understanding by and between Defiance College and Hicksville Exempted Village Schools from July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2017 for the hosting of education interns and practicum students. Recommend to approve an adoption agreement with Ohio Public Employees Deferred Compensation Program administered by the Ohio Public Employees Deferred Compensation Board. Most of that was in that light meeting that we had in our packets.
Okay. Are they going to come out and do a presentation of the deferred comp?
They can if you want them to.
Well, I mean, if people don't know about it, I mean, I know they come out.
Yes.
To,
when I worked at the village, I had, like, if we had new employees, I would have them come out. So maybe one of the first meetings of the year when the teachers come out, I can see if they come to that.
As many days as you want. I mean, it's a good program. It's a great program.
Yeah, I think it's a great program. It's a good one.
Any other discussion on these topics?
I did
want to make just one comment, that on the Central Ohio Medical Review, there is a cost associated with that, but this is a very good thing to do. I think the cost would be approximately $3,390, and then on top would be the actual fees that on top.
Okay.
Thank you for clarification.
Any other discussion or commentary?
I remember reading in that there was something about the state had to agree, like, on when the evaluation was, and it was going to be like more money if they didn't. Like, was there a double evaluation?
I know that the state is kind of in limbo right now. They're not sure how to proceed. They're saying that the information I've always received is like August 1st is like the deadline as to when these IEP services need to be signed off by the doctors. That's what the service is providing. I know that the state isn't quite sure if August is going to be the deadline, but I think the sooner we can get it in and the sooner you can get those services going and have that documentation, the better off you are, because you never know what the state might come up with to make the change. So.
Anything else? Roll call, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Missouri?
Yes.
Mr. Beck?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Following elementary school student fees, there it is. Preschool, $45. Grades K through 12, $55. Flat fee. Recommend to approve the middle school, high school athletic code handbook. Recommend to approve participation in the national school breakfast and lunch program and the Title I and Title IIA programs for the 2016-2017 school year. Recommend to approve the activity advisor and coach handbook for the 2016-2017 school year. Recommend to approve the athletic ticket prize for the 2016-2017 school year. Recommend to extend recognition and congratulations to Kate Murphy for her participation at the International Science and Engineering Fair in Phoenix, Arizona in May. Recommend to extend recognition and appreciation to Community Memorial Hospital for providing 122 physicals to prospective athletes on Thursday, May 28, 2016. Grant approval to the superintendent to request from the Ohio Department of Education a waiver. Minimum school year standards for the 2016-2017 school year by requesting that 2 student days be used for teacher in-services, and to recommend to cancel the July 11, 2016 regular school board meeting. One thing that I want to address, just out of curiosity, on the back of the elementary student handbook was commencement date, but on the back of the middle school, high school on the calendars, there was no commencement date. I'm like, So maybe we want to add that June 4th to the bottom of the back of that student handbook for this year.
Well, I don't think we did it because we talked about the gap between this year's
and the school year. That date technically hasn't been established yet by the folks. We always board approve that.
Yeah, it is on the back of the elementary.
But those calendars that are on the back of those handbooks are like a working document. I mean, sometimes things change, the programs, the different programs and stuff that are listed on there. So I wouldn't, I'd look at that as a reference, but that's not the law.
So we're not graduating?
No, we're not going to graduate anybody next year.
Miana's stuck with me for at least another year.
No, we talked about women graduation.
That's a shame to do it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So our kids getting out 35 years should be as bad.
I did not like the way we did it this year.
That was the one that was too long.
Yeah, because it's on most of the other calendars. That's why it is on the district.
Because I just took it from the district calendar. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Put it on the elementary one.
It's okay. It's
all right. Yeah, it's no big deal.
It's
just
on the elementary page 12.
Page 12, number 2.
No additional students.
The athletic ticket prices, I know you guys are voting, of course, to accept that. I wanted to hit on that a little bit. I know you guys are aware, you've been on the board for a while, but once a month, the GMC principals, we all meet to talk about, in all honesty, joking aside, it's mostly wrestling and cheerleading, but we can talk about other things. but this is one of these topics with the AEs. They meet, and then we meet the week after the AEs. And so then we have to kind of vote on different items for the Constitution for the GMC. And one thing that we're running into is with athletic ticket prices, no one wants to see those go up, okay? Because, you know, we talk about the attendance of students and the problem it causes for attendance when, you know, a kid can't afford, you know, $6 to get into the gate at a game. But what's happening is there are referee shortages in football and basketball and umpires in baseball. I mean, they're just not out there, and it's become very competitive. And we are actually one of the lowest paying conferences in Northwest Ohio. And the TAC and Toledo Public Schools, for their football referees or line judges, umpires, we're going to call them, they actually just bumped it to where I think it's going to go to $100 or $110 a game. And I think we're going from 65 to 70. The NWOAL, I think, is going up to 80 or 85 a game. So, you know, as a judge or, you know, as a whatever you do, an official, they're starting to choose. I can make $85 here. I can make $70 there. I can make $100 here. I can make $70 there. You know, and it's unfortunate, but that's kind of the nature of the beast right now. And then on top of that, you know, could we get away with not raising ticket prices? Yeah, we have a pretty healthy athletic budget because, you know, we have a town to support our athletic. We have a lot of people who go to our games. But there are other schools that are in our conference that are smaller and they don't have the support. And they struggle. Their budget for athletic teams is not there. And so they have to have these increases to sustain a budget to pay for their officials. And we can't, as Hicksville and Tenora, for example, who have healthy budgets, we can't say, well, we're not going to raise ticket prices, all you guys have to. It's a conference decision. It's not Hicksville, it's a conference. So just give some background information on that.
And this is something you see will probably change relatively soon, ticket prices.
As in?
Increasing ticket prices.
Again?
One more time. Yeah. I mean, do you think that that's going to happen?
I would hate to say yes, but, I mean, everything is more expensive. It's unfortunate. It is. I don't have an answer. If there's an answer, every school will be doing it.
Yeah.
I wish we could get ticket prices down because I think it would increase attendance. Because there's a big difference between $2 or $3 to get into a game and $6 to get into a game. So I think football games are $8 now to get in. Football is
six.
Still six. Okay. So
I do have a question on the athletic code. Does the weekly eligibility checks?
Paul Obermeyer and Jeff Hawt. And it's, when we say weekly, please keep in mind it's not Fridays. It's the last day of the week. So, and the kids are warned and warned and warned again. So, like Thanksgiving break, Wednesday is the last day of that week. That weekly eligibility check is on Wednesday. And then you're ineligible the following week. So, you can still play that Saturday night game on Thanksgiving weekend, but you can't play the following week. So that weekly grade check, let's say on Friday, and then you're still ineligible that Friday, Saturday night for basketball, but you're eligible the following week after that. They do a really nice job of that too. And the Fort County Career Center, they send us their grade reports every week.
Okay, so the coaches are responsible for checking the athletes' daily attendance, but the grade level eligibility checks is done by the
coaches. Trust me that the coaches are checking that too.
No.
It's just that officially that check
yes.
comes
okay.
through the
Well, agency. I just noticed the yeah. it states who the coaches are of each sport are responsible for checking athlete's daily attendance, but it doesn't specify who does the weekly eligibility.
To give you a perfect scenario, what happens is like Coach Smith on Monday, Tuesday, no one knows a 5-day week. On Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, he's checking attendance and grades, saying you need to get your grades in. You need to do a better job because he knows on Friday, Mr. Hall, Mr. Obermeyer checks, you may be ineligible. So typically the coaches do a really nice job of trying to stay on those kids. And a majority of our athletes are always eligible. I mean, I would like to say, you know, every once in a while we might have one or two actual athletes ineligible. The majority of the kids that are ineligible are the ones that aren't even participating. But we get that list and it has athletes and non-athletes.
What Jen's saying is we list on who's responsible for one thing, but the other one is kind of blank, so maybe it should
yeah.
say be checked by athletic directors or something, you know, along those lines. Right? That's kind of what you're...
I just didn't know because it wasn't, I mean, one was specified and one wasn't, so it's just a
What's the wording on the eligibility checks?
So under academic eligibility, it says weekly eligibility checks will take place every Friday or last school day of the week, beginning the fifth week of the grading period of the following week's contest.
Okay, and you want to specify who?
It doesn't mention who does, versus the next paragraph says coaches of each sport are responsible for checking athletes' daily attendance.
Okay, I'll add that. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Okay, I just wanted to say what Jeff was saying about eligibility. Going to awards programs, most of them are on the honor roll.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, most of our athletes are 3.0 above honor roll.
Right. You do a great job.
It's quite impressive. Okay. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Kinsler?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Okay. Next item of business, motion.
Second. Board resolution to authorize employer pickup of employee contributions state teacher retirement system. And this is just what we had discussed with Mr. Countryman's pickup on the pickup. It's just kind of explaining it. Okay. Any discussion on this? No? Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Okay, it passes 5-0.
Thank you, Denny.
I'll second.
And this one is board resolution of adoption of a plan under the program by eligible employer. Do you have anything that you want to address with this or
what about? I mean, if there's any questions in regards to the Ohio Deferred Comp program, I'd be happy to try to answer them, but
it's pretty standard.
Mm-hmm.
Discussion?
And it's supported by the state, so.
Okay, so roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
And Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to our multiple addendums. Okay. So the addendum to minutes and financials. Motion.
I think you can just read them.
Okay. To approve final changes to fiscal year 2016 permanent appropriations as presented. To approve the following fiscal year 2017 temporary appropriations, 80% of prior year's expenses for all funds except state and federal grants. Discussion.
All right. Roll call. Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Next.
Bubba.
Awesome. Board resolution for final appropriations. Okay. Any discussion on this final appropriations? If not, roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Next.
I'll move.
Thank you, Dan.
I'll second.
And this is a board resolution for temporary appropriations. Of course, there was some more light reading on all of this. Any discussion? All right, roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
I'll second.
Thank you, Linda. And this is... it's certified that the Hicksville Exempted Village School District has sufficient funds to meet the contract obligation payment or expenditure for the above resolutions. Discussion? No. All right, roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mizer?
Yes.
Mr. Vetter?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Addendum to employment of classified staff. Second. Recommend to approve the following for bus inspection in June at current driving rate pay, Brian Z. Dyke and Diane Z. Dyke, and recommend to increase substitute custodial pay rate to $15 per hour. Summer mowing groundskeeping rate increase should be retroactive to June 1st of 2016. Just paying them for the hard work that they do. Okay.
more than what my daughter makes lifeguarding. That'd be nice. Discussion. All right, roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mather?
Yes.
Mr. Better?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Addendum to other business.
I'll move.
Recommend to approve the following breakfast lunch prices for the 2016-2017 school year. Elementary breakfast $1.25, middle school high school breakfast $1.25, adult lunch $2.85, elementary lunch $2.25, middle school high school lunch $2.55, extra milk 35 cents. Discussion.
Do we want to add our other addendum on
this? I've got that
no.
on the bottom. Okay. That's what I'm going to do next. Thank you. Any discussion on this? No? All right, roll call, please.
Mr. Carrier? Or Mrs. Carrier? I'm sorry.
Either way, yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
Mr. Better?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Okay, we're going to add then. I would like to make a motion to approve the emergency service agreement proposal number 1511C. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Discussion? I think we got it all in when we were talking earlier,
does the
right?
The motion need to say which plan we're accepting?
It's
probably should.
Yeah, sure.
The 10-year cash payment.
Okay.
10-year warranty cash payment.
Cash payment.
10-year
yeah.
warranty cash. Cash payment.
Do we need to say it's coming from PI fund or not?
Let's.
Probably won't all.
Yeah, it won't all. But let's let. How about we not?
Okay.
And we'll figure.
Okay. No problem.
Here, I didn't.
Yeah, the one thing I just for that down to that penny amount, it might change a little bit because we had taken three lights off at the bus barn, not knowing what our plans were at the bus barn, and GD emailed me back that he was going to give an updated for replacing those and figuring the savings from those three light fixtures. That was one other thing I forgot when I was down there in March was. They asked about other lighting that maybe you missed out on. I never even thought about all the athletic buildings, all the can lights and the football field buildings, the press box, the weight room, the old weight room down there, and the bus barn. So those are also added in on this. But we'd remove three of the lights at the bus barn. And so I should get an updated one, so it could be a couple hundred dollars.
But like the press box, some of those don't get used very many hours.
Exactly. Here, no. So well, no, those are on PhotoWise.
Pardon?
Those are all on PhotoWise, all the outside, it's all the outside lighting.
Okay. That would add up.
Yeah, that's less than about a two and a half year payback.
Yeah, I would add those.
So do we need to wait on this then, or the price will just change a few hundred dollars?
Okay,
probably most of it do.
So we are.
So you're approving the project for a cash payment, 10-year warranty.
Yeah, correct. Proposal number 1511C, a 10-year warranty cash payment.
Which roughly the $194,000.
Yeah, which will cover the change of the price changes.
Yeah.
Other discussion?
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
Mr. Better?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0. Do we have any other discussion tonight? All right. Any unannounced guests wishing to address the board? We are not going into executive session tonight. I may get to watch some of Charlie's game. motion for adjournment by Craig, a second. We do have to, and then the next board meeting to be held on?
August.
Probably fair week.
No, August the 11th.
Yeah, I think that's what we're doing. Yeah, August 11th.
August 11th at 6. And
Thursday.
August 8th.
Wait, let's check.
August 8th. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm looking at July.
Let's check
August
8th.
My bad. Sorry. Yeah. August 8th. So would that be our regular second Monday?
Yes.
And thank you for doing the June a little later. So we can eliminate July 1.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. Carrier?
Yes.
Mr. Iden?
Yes.
Mrs. Jones?
Yes.
Mrs. Mazur?
Yes.
Mr. Better?
Yes.
We are adjourned at 7:20.